Good morning. Welcome to everyone. This is for me, and I think for many of us who are working on environmental issues, economic issues, energy issues, science and technology issues, a very exciting day in the sense that now we are going to actually be implementing and fulfilling a vision that Secretary Clinton had articulated months ago and was encapsulated in one of the key recommendations of the QDDR, and that is we're announcing the office of the Undersecretary for Economic Growth, Energy, and the Environment. And this is going to focus on, as I noted, some very important priorities for the United States, for the President, for Secretary Clinton, and for the entire Department, and for myself and my colleagues, and that is a very proactive set of approaches on the environment, on economics, on energy, and on science and technology issues. Before I get into the organizational details of this, I just want to emphasize that there are organizational changes that are going to be made in terms of a new bureau, for instance, for energy, what's going to be called ENR. But let me just emphasize, this is not just about bureaucratic reorganization. This is really about utilizing our resources in the department more efficiently, focusing more directly on these issues, establishing a cross-fertilization of ideas among these various functions that I've mentioned, and finding ways in which the energy area, the environmental area, and the economic area, and the science area can mutually reinforce one another. And we can, as a result of this, utilize our resources not more efficiently and also direct these resources in a more focused way on the kinds of issues that I'll be describing, and also to break down silos. You know, having been in government before and now coming back to government after 25 years out, one of the things that I think is very important, and it's really a key point for the Secretary of State, is to break down silos and have a lot more interaction among various parts of the department so they can work together on similar objectives. So what this is going to look like as a result of this process that we're undertaking is there'll be in the E family, there'll be the Bureau of Oceans and Environmental and Scientific Affairs, OES, led by Assistant Secretary Carrie Ann Jones. And while we're announcing this today, Carrie Ann and I have been working together for many months now in anticipation of this, and she has been giving me a lot of briefings on environmental issues, and I've been very actively involved in a whole number of things with environmental groups and on environmental priorities in the State Department. So Carrie Ann will continue to be the Assistant Secretary there and will be the leader of the effort in this Bureau. Then the Bureau of Economic and Business Affairs, it was EEB, but now it's EB because the energy function has moved to another bureau. That'll be led by Assistant Secretary Jose Fernandez, who is currently Assistant Secretary of EEB. And the Bureau of Energy Resources, which will be called ENR, will be led by the Secretary's Coordinator for International Energy, Carlos Pascual, who's done a fabulous job in standing up this bureau in, I'd say, record time for creating a new bureau. And then we have the Office of the Science and Technology Advisor, which is known as STAS, S-T-A-S, led by a very distinguished scientist named Dr. Bill Colglazer, who has really been quite helpful in strengthening the capabilities of this department in the area of science and technology. And we've worked very closely with him in trying to inject science and technology more directly into a number of aspects of our policies. And then, finally, we're going to establish the Office of the Chief Economist of the State Department. We haven't selected the individual yet, but this will be a person who both understands economic issues, financial issues, and how they relate to our broader foreign policy. as the secretary put in her speech in New York at the New York Economic Club, she wanted to have people in the State Department who can read a Bloomberg terminal and can also read Foreign Affairs magazine and understand both of them and how they relate to one another. So that's the kind of person we're looking for. And we hope to make some announcements soon, but we're undergoing a search process. Again, this announcement today really is a culmination of an effort that we've been developing over a period of time to implement the Secretary's commitment to economic statecraft, to environmental sustainability, to energy security as fundamental elements in our overall foreign policy. And our goal here in each one of these is to really do two things. One, we want to use these to strengthen our capability to serve the interests of the American people abroad. And that is, we're emphasizing, for instance, export promotion, the President's National Export Initiative. We're emphasizing attracting foreign investment to the United States, which creates a lot of jobs. Energy is critically important to the American people. It's quite obvious when oil prices go up or there are disruptions in supplies, they have an effect which is geostrategic, but it also has a major impact on the American economy. And of course, the environment has become an increasingly important issue for Americans and indeed for people around the world. So we're trying to look at all these. And what we found as we've been developing this process is that there are a lot of synergies. There are a lot of areas of cross-fertilization among them. And I think that's part of the reason. The goal here, as I say, is not just to move boxes around, but we're going to have regular meetings between the heads of these various bureaus and experts in these bureaus with one another. Just to give you one example, there are a lot more that we've developed, but one that I think really makes a lot of sense where you combine all three of these is in the area of working with American business and with the American environmental community, because increasingly we found that American businesses that look for ways of saving energy and saving raw materials in their production and in their factories and the way they produce their goods and services and the way they build their buildings can do a number of things to, one, improve their bottom line, that is to say, make higher profits. And they do it by utilizing resources more efficiently, utilizing energy more efficiently, raw materials more efficiently, and other things. So it's good for the environment. It reduces our dependence on energy, and it enables them to be more profitable. So we're looking for more and more ways of cross-fertilizing the work of these various departments. You can go back to the QDR of December 2010 and see a little bit more of the details of what we're doing and how it was spelled out in the QDR. But this is basically the organizational framework that we're going to pursuing. And you know, one of the points that I made, and I just want to emphasize again, we understand that we're in a resource-constrained world, and therefore, when we look at this and we look at the kind of world we're facing, it's particularly important that we use our resources in the most efficient way. This is a very high priority for the Secretary coming out of the private sector. It's something I've focused on as well. And we think that this combination and the cross-fertilization and the mutually reinforcing elements of this is going to be a good way of utilizing our resources, our human resources more efficiently, our financial resources more efficiently. We're not adding any people within the State Department to do this. We're reprioritizing, we're restructuring, and we're creating synergies so that we use the human resources we have, which are really quite substantial in this building, a lot of expertise, and utilizing this expertise in the most effective way to accomplish our foreign economic objectives, our international economic objectives, and fundamentally, and the bottom line is, how do we best serve the interests of the American people and do the kind of things in our international economic policy that serve their interests in terms of economic growth, in terms of energy stability and security, and in terms of improving the global environment, and in ways that benefit the United States in a very direct and a very sustained fashion. So this is my quick introduction. I'm very happy to answer any of your questions. And if you have some now, great. If you don't want to follow up later, happy to talk to any of you. So.
Yeah, hi, Andy from Reuters.
Hi.
When there are people reading Bloomberg terminals, you also got
you
people
could put
reading
Reuters in there
terminals.
Too. You could put Reuters in there too.
Just a couple of quick questions.
Yeah.
I was wondering if you could.
When I was in the private sector, I read both. So.
How Todd Stern's operation fits into this,
yes.
If it does at all, and how that climate
yes.
change part fits in.
Great point.
Great point.
What we're doing, you know, Todd and I have worked very closely. He works very closely with OES, as you know, a lot of people in OES. His job and the people who support him will not be changed at all in this process. The people who supported him in OES will continue to do that, and so there will not he will continue to do exactly what he was doing. He will continue to get very strong support from people in OES and other parts of the department who are supporting him now, and certainly he has very strong support from me and from my immediate team. So this won't affect what he's doing or the procedures or the structure for Todd's.
So is that a
Todd's
standalone
efforts.
Bureau? Does that count as?
Well,
is
it's
that
separate. He reports to the secretary,
right.
but he can call on other people in the building to support him as he does his work, which he's, as you know, doing right now.
Right. And the second question was, I was hoping you could talk a little bit more in depth about the ENR part of this.
Yeah.
And specifically, what sorts of issues you foresee that group taking
sure.
on, and how you're going to actually promote something as sort of amorphous as energy security in a diplomatic way?
Sure. Let me just go through a few elements of that. One is, you know, we want to work with other countries around the world. We have, as you know, the International Energy Agency that attempts to strengthen cooperation among oil-consuming countries, but also work more closely with energy supplying companies to countries in order to get greater transparency, greater information about global energy markets, to work with countries to help them, help encourage diversification of energy. You know, we've been working on things like how do you develop new sources of energy, new ways of transmitting energy through greater diversification, both for the United States and for other countries as well. So, one is the energy security part, which is encourage more production in countries that have more leeway for producing more oil, but also improving things like pipeline systems so that there can be greater diversification of supplies around the world, which help us and help our allies and friends, say, in Western Europe. So the strategic part is very important. The second part is to help with governance in the sense that a lot of countries, as you doubtless know, have large amounts of energy resources, and making sure there's transparency in the way the financial returns on those resources are utilized. Transparency, accountability is very important. The Secretary has spoken of this, and this is another area that the new Bureau will be working on. And third is with respect to energy development. As you doubtless know, in many countries, Afghanistan, many countries around the world, delivering energy, in some cases even countries that produce a lot of energy, getting it to people in rural villages, distributed energy, is very complicated. And we're trying to do, and Carlos Pascual and his team are trying to do, is work with developing countries in order to find ways of helping them to develop energy resources that support the development effort. And those can be better grids or distributed energy or solar or hydropower or wind energy, so that you can get more energy to the people or the parts of the country that need it for their development. So those will be the several areas that this Bureau will work on. But in the past, we've had an energy function. It's been under the Economic Bureau, which was then EEB, but the Secretary thought that, and I think it was a very important point, that it needed more visibility and it needed more prioritization and it needed a more direct focus. So by pulling all these things together, energy security, energy stability, dealing with energy